I'm going to go ahead and introduce our only speaker for the day. On our screen, presenting will be Mr. Mohammed A. Imam, who's our consultant orthopedic surgeon at the Rowley Bristow Orthopedic Unit at Ashford and St. Peter's Hospital NHS Foundation Trust. He's also a faculty member at the East Anglia and the University of East London. He's also a chief investigator of national and international studies, and he has more than 100 publications, including under his name, including in peer-reviewed papers and in book chapters. He has edited a book that uses stem cells in orthopedics. He was also awarded multiple distinctive international awards and traveling fellowships from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, from the AANA, the nurse anesthetist, the ISAKOS, the International Arthroscopy, Knee Surgery, and Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, E4 and the AO, and others. He has completed 2 degree level theses, including a PhD on the healing of rotator cuff tendons, and successfully filed several patents. Now, please give him the due respect. And again, don't unmute your mics during the session. I will go ahead and let Mr. Imam share his presentation with us, and he will enlighten us with his presentation today. Thank you again, Mr. Imam, for your time.
Thank you, Raoul, for the lovely introduction. Thank you, everyone, for attending this webinar. And thank you for Raoul and Sam and all the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. It's a pleasure to be here today, and I hope you will make the best benefit out of this talk. I've split it into 2 parts. The first part is steps in order to publish a paper in wherever you are. And the second part, which is the main bulk, is how to write up a paper. I've written a few myself, so as per the introduction by Raoul, so it should be hopefully beneficial to you. So we all know scientific writing, no less than any other form of writing, reflects a demanding creative process, not merely an act. And so it's a process of writing changes. It's a sort of checkbox exercise. You have to be creative whenever you write any publication, but the quality of report actually depends on the quality of the research and the quality of the writing. And I review a lot of publications. I review a lot of submissions for many journals, including top-notch journals in orthopedics and in surgery general. So first and foremost, what makes good writing is actually the good is what it requires. It needs the writer to communicate an idea clearly and effectively. This is even more important in scientific writing, because the whole point of scientific writing is to contribute to medical knowledge. So the first question, who wants to publish? Actually, everyone wants to publish nowadays. You know, if you're an FY1, CT1, quarterly knee, medical student, you need to publish, to contribute to research in order to improve your CV, the savvy CV builders, registrars wanting to get into training, post-training registrars or self-directed registrars wanting to get into consultant posts. Actually, consultants want to publish their work, nurses, physiotherapists, managers. So in the current milieu, everyone is very keen on publishing. So why do we do research? That's a very important question. Finding reasons why research is important seems like no-brainer. But many people avoid to be involved in research because they think they don't have the quality or the attributes to contribute to research. It's not true. So we want to do research to answer questions. So this is a quest for everyone. We'll discuss it at the end. What is this? Who did this? Where is this? What's its relationship to shoulders? And what's its relationship to me? Okay, so this 15-step approach to publishing to start a research project would be, we'll go through it quickly and we'll introduce the write-up techniques in the middle. Simply, you need to have a topic, explain the topic, allocate the team, literature review, agreeing a timetable, strategy, discuss it with your peers, have the results and the data analysis, sit down, start writing up your results, and edit the paper, submit it, redraft it, re-edit it, rewrite it. It's a long process. This was popularized by Richard Field from Epsom, Professor Field. So first, you have an idea. I'd like to do a research on this question. Is the question clearly defined? Is it a good question? The answer would be two things. First, you discuss with your peers, discuss with experts in the field. All of us have seniors in every place we work in. Discuss with them, what is that? More importantly, you do your literature review. See what's happening elsewhere and whether this is a trending topic. And then you'll get the answer. Was it clearly answered before? Is this topic a strategic important to my institution? So simply with the idea, if you work in an elective center, don't do a paper on trauma. Don't do a study on trauma. If you're in a trauma center, focus on trauma. It's strategic important for your trauma institute or for an institute. And then you can always use the help of others, like a few collaborative work being going on nowadays, especially in the COVID era. And then ask yourself, what sort of technical aspects I need to cover? Do I need to have a statistician on board? Do I need ethics approval? In most departments, they have a research and development department in most hospitals. You can discuss with them and then find a journal that would be interesting in publishing your work. So in order to have an idea, you have to give due attention to a few points, which will allow you to focus on critical issues. Your idea should be original, if you can. You know, this is an ideal paper. If you can have an original idea, or an idea that would address controversy, or an idea that would help answering few questions in your specialty. The idea should be relevant, with good scope and manageable. Again, choose a topic that you can research and come up with a good research paper in the light of your resources. These resources can be personnel, can be colleagues, and so. Nowadays, there are different research opportunities, like doing collaborative works. There are a few running from Ashford and St. Peter's, and I think you can always contribute by data collection, by different aspects, and most importantly, by writing up your own projects, which will ultimately happen if you are interested. The topic you choose should be relevant to your field of study. The purpose of conducting research is to contribute to the body of the knowledge and inform practice. You know, research shouldn't be on revision hip replacements or revision shoulder replacements. It shouldn't be fancy ideas, simple things. Like, you know, you can publish a proper research if you do a proper, well-conducted study, looking at very common stuff done in every DGH all over the globe. Like plaster, what type of plaster, comparing different types of plasters in common fractures. There are different aspects of research that you can always do. The idea is crucial. I cannot emphasize the idea more. It should be relevant. And you after having the idea, you should have a research question. And I always use this mnemonic in order to remember what is the ideal research question. The ideal research question is design. It's detailed, explicit, answerable, thought through, spend some time thinking about it, housed, supported, important, changes practice, and not self. Okay? So these are very important aspects, and the research question is the most important part of any study before you start it. You have to have a clear research question because it will dictate everything else you will have in your research. And then find your team. You know, we work in teamworks all the time. You have to have your team and explain the idea to the team, allocate the job if you're a senior member of the team, or even if you're a junior member of the team, you should have an expert who can help you with the technical aspect, or you can use their data, know where are you going to conduct the research, who you need help, what help do you need, and how you're going to undertake the research. And then do the literature review. Very important. You know, it's always written. Very few ideas are 100% novel. Maybe with COVID, we have a new concepts nowadays. But I think in all specialties, usually there is something in the literature that can help you in answering the research questions you're thinking of. And so when you do your literature review, now you have another look on your questions and redefine the questions again. And this is a very important slide in any research project. How are you going to analyze the data and how you're going to undertake the research? It's beyond the scope of this lecture, but you will find answers to this important topic in all the presentations given by all my esteemed colleagues in this set of webinars. Finally, now, how to write a paper. This is the fun part. And actually, sometimes I review very good papers. English isn't my first language. I understand it can be a problem writing up, but it is a creative task that you can undertake by knowing the basics, and it's easy. And that's what we're going to do now. I've reviewed papers where abstract and introduction and research questions were brilliant. But then, you know, when they write it up or they do the research, it's actually lose its power and loses its weight. And so these sort of publications might not be successful eventually in a good journal. It could be successful if it is well written. Sometimes, and that's what I try to do most of the time, I can help with advice, but it's good opportunity now to put all this advice in one presentation for all of you. So how to structure a paper? On average, you know, there is always 3,000 papers have 3,000 words in total. Papers are actually you start with the introduction. Usually I'll give it 500 words. We'll go through all these items one by one now, followed by patients and methods. Usually this is the longest part of any presentation and one of the most important parts. And then results, which is usually 500 words, and then discussion, which is always 1,000 words. And if you think and if you look here, you can find, you know, if you tell me you're going to do a research comparing two different techniques for repairing the rotator cuff, I can start writing this paper even before you do the study. I can write the introduction because I can go through the knowledge. I can discuss the current knowledge, and finally, I'll add the research questions. I'll clearly write the methods and the patients and methods because planning is the most crucial part of any research project. So I can say we will start by doing this surgical technique versus this surgical technique. We need an institutional review. We need ethics review, and I'll write it up. Results, I'll leave it. That's the only section I cannot write unless we finish the study. And then discussion, I'll leave the first part, which is critical analysis of our data, but then I can find literature talking about different other parts, and I'll also leave the last part. So you can write 60% of your research paper the minute you have an idea about a research project. Results and parts of the discussion will be based on the outcomes of your research study. So introduction. Introduction also typically the shortest of sections. It's perhaps the most critical. The introduction must effectively state issues and formulate rationale for those issues and questions. Its organization might differ based on what sort of study. And actually, all what we do are three types of studies. It's either a novel finding where entirely haven't been done before, most applicable in case reports, or unless one of you is doing a substantive basic or clinical work, which would be impressive. And second part is confirmation study. We're agreeing with other studies that has been published before, or our results are actually a controversial ones that would address controversy among published data. So you have to be compatible. Your introduction should be compatible with the type of study. And so looking at what we've said, I write problem being addressed, and then what is the current knowledge in on that subject, and last sentence would be about your questions, hypotheses, and purposes. So if I'm structuring my introduction or to one of my research fellows or the trainees, first part should be introduction of the introduction, why this topic is important, why we're doing research on hip replacements. Second and third paragraph would be the rationale, why we're doing this study. So actually, because there was evidence published said so and so and so and so. And final paragraph would be the questions, hypotheses, or purposes. I always highly recommend, or one might think of formulating rationale and hypothesis as the Aristotelian logic. So taking the form of A, if A, B, and C, then D, E, and F. So what's A, B, and C? A, B, and C are accepted facts. These are published data. We know already that total neck of femur fractions is a crucial problem in hip, in orthopedics. Mortality is a common is a risk among them, and morbidity is high. So these are all accepted facts. It can either be published data or published observations or actual logical argument, like total hip, neck of femur fractions happen in elderly people. It is published, but it's common sense. But D, E, and F are logical outcomes or predictions, and that's the arc of the Aristotelian logic. So the premises come first from published data, and then you reflect in the last bits with logical consequences of what you're writing. This is important here. So also another practical tip, avoid in the final paragraph is really crucial. Don't say we report our data and all that stuff, because such statements fail to focus the readers and the writers' attention to the critical issues. Cut the clutter. Avoid writing long sentences. We aim to 1, 2, 3. Our hypothesis is 1, 2, 3. So what is the checklist here for introduction? Give background, questions being asked, and hypothesis tested, and study design stated. If none of these, if one of these items aren't there, it's not right. So what about patients and methods? Let's do an example of first an introduction from a recent publication that we've done. So you start by giving background, rotator cuff repair techniques, and then despite our improved understanding, we thought we have to do a clinical trial to prospectively compare one versus second. That's it. So next part is actually an important part. And in principle, patients and methods should contain, is the longest section for sure. I've said 1500 words. It should contain adequate detail for another investigator to replicate the study. In practice, such detail might not be practical, might not be desirable. If it is, we know the methods and this has been extensively published, you can give a reference to what was published. But doing descriptions will make it difficult, but you have to write enough details for another author reading this paper from a different country to reproduce the study. You mentioned stuff here like institutional review board, ethics committee, what sort of population and demographics. And usually when I'm reviewing papers, I see people writing population and demographics in the results section and I ask them to put it in the method section. You have to include your inclusion and exclusion criteria. And the last bit is the statistical analysis section. This is the longest checklist among any of the sections because it's a very crucial part. And if I'm reviewing a paper, I'll read the last paragraph of the introduction, what is the research question? And then I'll read the methods, what sort of methods did they follow? If looks sound, then I'll read the paper. If it doesn't look sound or doesn't look appropriately selected or inadequate methods, that's a straightforward rejection. Questions that you think that you should include is how many patients and what sort of power study have you done? How did you choose your patients and were these patients randomized? How were they randomized? What sort of population and demographics have you done? What sort of statistical tests have you done? What sort of outcome scores used and state the results? And other aspects like number of patients, cases, laterality, and all these. Survival analysis is important if you're reporting prostheses or implant. And of course, the ethical approval and the informed consent is crucial. So for stats, you have to mention what tests did you use, why did you use these tests, what is the p values of these tests, and whether your findings are significant or insignificant. And sometimes we have the trend of thinking, oh, if my results aren't significant, I wouldn't get that published. But actually, it's not true. If you're telling me that there is no difference between cemented and cementless hip replacements, these are results, then we'll use the cheaper one or we'll use the quicker one. So no significance is also results. So look here, if you see, like you have to mention, if this is another example, patient information sheet was included. We've mentioned ethical approvers, ethical approval and information sheets, patient outcome measures, and all the outcome measures discussed. And then how did we do preoperative assessment? How did we measure this tear size? I'm talking here about single versus double row rotator cuff repair. It was an RCT. And then we wrote the surgical technique for each. So we are very specific about what technique did we use, which patients did we select, what sort of inclusion and exclusion criteria, and what sort of outcomes did we use, how did we follow up those patients, and what sort of statistical analysis did we use, which program did we use, and our flow diagram. So that if another author from India or from Egypt wants to replicate this study, they will take a look on everything there and say, oh, okay, so that's it. So they telling us that the results and so using this surgical technique and this study has been undertaken in that specific way. So what is next? You finished your methods. Actually, results, although we spend all our work looking for results while undertaking the research, the results section should, if the questions and issues have been adequately focused on the introduction, and the results section shouldn't be long. Generally, one way of saying so, the first paragraphs of the results should persuade the reader of the validity of the methods. And then you should address each highlighted points in the research question by asking them in the results. And finally, the last paragraph should report new or unexpected finding. And there is a very easy way to go through it. So I'll give you an example. If you read the last paragraph of the introduction, these are the research questions. And then if you should be able to read the first sentence of each paragraph of the results to get an idea about what results did they found. It is crucial to remember that it's not results isn't the data, it's our interpretation of the data. So we look at results, we say that those who are having double row rotator cuff repair have better outcomes in larger tears. So that means the reader should be able to get that idea just from reading the first sentence of the paragraph. Write it in a way that's a story. It's a storytelling exercise. So outcome is increased or decreased and should be written in a short, specific sentences that dictate the message clearly and convey clearly. I personally prefer to use the actual p values, which convey more information than stating a value less than or unless it is a very low p value. So state absolute numbers, means and ranges or medians, ranges should be stated. Logical order, so you've mentioned your primary outcomes is X. X should come first. If X is more important, go for X. Significant data comes first, presented clearly. If you use centimeter in the text, use centimeter in the table, all of it should be the same, and units should be given for any results. What about figures and tables? Figures is crucial. Figures are would give a better idea about what's happening, and we all, from being kids, we enjoy figures and looking at diagrams. It should present information which would be difficult to describe in text form. Avoid using too many figures, avoid using too many tables. Text will dictate a clear message, but sometimes figure would even be better. So if you think as a reader, put yourself in the reader's shoes, do I need to see that as a figure or do I need to see that sort of information written as a text? And if you think about it, figures also may need some explanation. You should say, forward, I'm assessing here 1, 2, 3, whatever you're assessing. And the figure legend should contain the major points within the framework of the questions raised. Explanation should be written in complete sentences, and we'll go through practical tips later. So if you, to summarize what I've mentioned earlier, a reader should be able to read questions of in the last paragraph of introduction, give answers in the first sentence of each paragraph, in results and in the figures legend. So what about tables? Two important tips here. One, if you want to bore your readers, add a lot of tables. See yourself. How many papers have you read that you've actually looked at the tables? A text will always be better. The other thing, which is crucial as well, is if you write something in the text, avoid making a table for it. So it's either a text or table. Don't duplicate. And ensure the figure legends and the tables legends are comprehensive and clearly state what the table shows. So what about the checklist here? Figures checklist, check with the instructions to author when you submit the paper, how many figures can you include? Make sure the legends are comprehensive, as we've clearly as mentioned earlier. Ensure all the axis labels have been applied to charts and tables. So if you have an x-axis, which is number of patients, y-axis, which is whatever outcomes, that should be the case for all figures. If you're using histology figures for basic sciences, you have to mention stains and the magnification used. An example, first, we've mentioned demographic data, preoperative scores. So this is not, we're not mentioning the data itself, it's comparison, because this is a randomized controlled trial. It's a comparison between demographics of this patient group and this patient group. And in RCTs, this should be insignificant. So this gives the reader the assurance that this is a properly conducted randomized controlled trial. And then you add another table for all outcome scores or comparison of post-operative outcome scores. However, here we mentioned that combined result shows significant or insignificant improvement. And then figures, legends should be comprehensive. And if you need to do an illustration, put an illustration in. Pictures should be augmenting and giving a better idea about what you're discussing in your paper. For tables, you know, this is a boring table for anyone looking at it, but it's important for someone who's really, for the reviewer, in order to understand the validity of this research group, of this research study, and for someone who's interested to know and look deeper into studies published. What about the discussion? I know many people are really worried about the discussion. Also, discussion is easy. It's not really a big deal. I personally think the best way of doing your discussion is to first paragraph, you should summarize and restate the problem and the question and your results. And then explore the limitations and assumptions. And this is really important. I personally think an exploration of limitations of your study and comparison with other published study is next here rather than at the end of the manuscript, because interpretation of what follows depends on this limitation. If you fail to explore the limitations of your own study, and you're the expert of your own study, no one is more expert than what you've done. If you choose to ignore them or you don't explore them well, that's actually raise my suspicion as a reviewer or as an intellectual reader about the validity of your study. This failure to explore limitation can potentially mislead the reader. Exploration of these limitations needs to only to be brief, but all critical issues needs to be discussed, and the reader should be persuaded that you've done a very valid study exploring and you're aware of own limitations. And studies published in Nature, in The Lancet, in BMJ has their own limitation. So what about comparison and contrast with other information? So we've mentioned in this example we've been giving, you know, we've mentioned that double row rotator cuff repair is better for large or massive tears. There is no difference between single and double row. Then limitations of this study is that we didn't we had the follow-up of 3 years. Maybe it's better to have it for 2 years or 5 years. And then we've seen published, others have conferred the same idea. Others have agreed with what we've agreed, while X, Y, and Z didn't agree to what we've said. And in conclusion, this conclusion is also based on our discussion, not only on our discussion, but also an exploration of other evidence, recent evidence. You can say that, you know, in your conclusions, but it's purely based on your results. If there are any discrepancies, just say, why do you think these discrepancies are? Maybe because they use different technique, different implant, different surgical process, different rehabilitation protocol. So that's why you have a different results. We assume it might be the case. And then you reach your conclusions. So the checklist for discussion here is the discussion should be appropriate to the question. It should be few paragraphs. First paragraph, what you found. Second paragraph, your limitations and the strengths of your study. And then what others have mentioned, whether they were against or supporting the results you found, and then state how your results will fit in the current knowledge and will these results change clinical practice and how it will change clinical practice. I personally, and I know a lot of researchers and a lot of academics, write the abstract last. The abstract here should be written after the entire manuscript is done. It's crucial that way, because now you finished writing your paper and you know you have to write the most readable part of your paper, because the reason relates to how the process of writing changes now. And you can actually change your process of thought accordingly while writing this paper. Many readers now access medical or scientific information via the internet. Very few would browse the hard copy material. Regardless of access, all readers will read your abstract. It is because that's what you will find on PubMed. And then they will look for other ways of having the full manuscript if your title and abstract attracts their attention. So, and actually many of the people who you've seen in meetings or so, sometimes they cite what they've read in the abstract. A compelling abstract contains questions, purpose, methods, and results, all sections. Each of these may be conveyed or one or two statements, and also avoid the statements of wasting space, because abstracts usually are short and there is a limit for abstracts. You cannot mention references or statistical values in the abstract, but you can mention there was significant difference and mention the p-value if needed, as some journals might ask you to do that. Always read instructions to authors, add the level of evidence to your abstract, have a clear hypothesis, questions asked, and design and results should be briefly described. And personally, I think you should always mention where the paper fits in the current knowledge. And so this is also same paper, same abstract, short sentences. We've compared so and so. This study took years to do, and it was 3 years follow-up. All results can be mentioned there, and then conclude, write the level of evidence and keywords. Finally, the title. The title is also as important as the abstract. It is important to capture the reader's attention. So titles can be either giving us what's there, so stage revision with antibiotic spacers for shoulders yields high infection control. That's it. We know this is a take-home message from the paper. If that's the case, it's fine. You can use a title that way, or you can use a descriptive title. Randomized control trial comparing to and so, aerosol generating procedures in trauma and orthopedics in the era of COVID-19 pandemic. What do we know? So sort of attracting attention. So references, always read the instructions to authors, only include peer-reviewed journals, textbooks, or monographs. I personally would highly recommend, especially if you're doing thesis, using referencing programs. It makes your life much easier. The thing with it, if you submit a paper somewhere, it's rejected, and then you try to submit it to somewhere else, you don't have to change all the referencing styles again. So it's really important. You can include online links, especially those well acceptable like NIH and NICE, NGRs or FDA websites. You can accept, you can also cite articles accepted in peer-reviewed journals, but if they are fully accepted. Avoid using abstracts and submitted articles because they might be fraud. It's not really proper research. Abstracts can be written in 200 words. So I would avoid by all means referencing to abstracts and submitted articles. So what is the checklist for references? Personally, we should include references in the last decade. The majority of your references should be in the last decade, unless you have seminal papers in the subjects that you want to include and you have full access to the seminal papers that you can read it. You have the full text, you can reference that as well. They should be inclusive, reduce bias. You know, we authors tend to self-cite our previous publications. If it is relevant, you can include them. If it isn't, don't include them. And reduce the number cited to only those who are fully relevant. So you've written your paper, you've done your checklist, and now the paper is ready. Read, find the journals. That journal should be relevant. It should be, so if you're doing an arthroplasty paper, go for the journal of arthroplasty. If it is a very good paper, go for a very good journal. If it is a mediocre paper, not very sound retrospective analysis without controls, go to a relevant journal. You can go to a higher journal for the sake of having your paper reviewed and all getting input from reviewers. But you have to identify the journal. Then the first draft. You write the first draft, unless it's a single citation, single authorship, you always have other authors. Send it to them. Few minds think better than one, and then team review of the draft. All should be included, and ethically, all should read and accept the final abstract before submitting the paper, unless for collaborative work where there is 150 authors. So then you start rewriting again based on all the editing you had. You actually will have also better thinking about what's happening eventually. So some helpful trips. First, find an interested journal, relevant topic, relevant quality, read the instructions to authors before submitting your paper, and find quick journals. Here in this paper, it is received in 1995 and accepted in 2006. That's not a journal I'd like you to submit your papers to. I'm not sure it's true or not, but I think it is true. And remember that peer review process is a long process, takes some time. You submit the paper, editor will take a look. They might reject it saying, oh, it's actually out of scope. That happens in your first early few publications, shouldn't happen now. And then they send it to reviewers. Reviewers take a look, send it to you, ask for revision. We have some publications that was revised 10 times. So send it back, revisions, we send it back to us. Usually it's not ideal, but big journals tend to do that. And always remember that the reviewing process is, there is always more than one reviewer, and things looks like, sometimes a reviewer might ask for different aspects to be changed. I personally think that reviewing process is one of the most unselfish acts in publications, because reviewers spend some time sending you comments. I've had papers rejected, and I was very grateful for the reviewer because they had constructive criticism. They spent a lot of time and effort on our work, and they wouldn't have any credit for doing so. So we can spend some time on our work, because this is of course a comic picture, but you can spend time on our work, and we get citation for it. It will be on our CVs forever that we published this paper at that time point. But as a reviewer, they are doing it for the sake of medical knowledge. And so they spend a lot of time in order to make a better publication. And some publications actually are way better. You know, you have a paper that you've submitted, you've asked the input of your peers, and multiple reviewers, experts in the subject made it way better. And that paper was published eventually. And you can take pride about this publication 5 or 10 years down the line. And of course, if the paper is accepted, these are great emails. It will make you happy. So final tips, ensure your word count is right. Make it fun to read. It's a story. Don't use abbreviations until it's spelled out. If you're going to use even, you know, some abbreviations can be used per se, like MRI, but even in scientific writing, you should mention what is the abbreviation for. And you should take all institutional or author names from your publication. If you want to be a good writer, read more and more publication. And as everything else, the rule of 10,000 hours of training is practice makes perfect. Practice writing, and it's a talent. Many people have it and maybe don't. But if you practice, you will make it better. And personally, I think this is really important. Writing up publications, cut your own words, cut the clutter. It's really important. Hemingway was the best writer in history, and he used short sentences. And avoid using passive voice. It's really irritating to read passive voice all the time. Avoid using long sentences. I couldn't emphasize that more. Avoid salami slicing. For those who don't know, if you have a paper that is a cohort paper describing different aspects and comparing different aspects, don't try to put it into two papers. Some of the data can be put in two and three data papers. If it is relevant, it is relevant and you can do it, but try to avoid salami slicing. And stop waiting for an inspiration and postponing things. Just start and avoid acronyms if you can, and avoid turning verbs into nouns. If you want to say, we produce coal. We don't say we are enjoying the production of coal. No, we produce coal. That's it. Use the verbs. Avoid converting verbs into nouns. Research is fun. Nobody is perfect. It's hard. Publish and flourish. It's a game, really. You can do it if you're interested and you have the persistence to do so. It's worth the effort. Do it for sake of contributing to medical knowledge. I'm not expecting everyone to write up Nobel-level publications, but you know, every little helps. And we've changed practice a lot in the last three decades based on scientific evidence. I recommend doing this course. It's a very free course, Writing in Sciences. I've met Christine in Stanford. She's a very lovely lady. She's an expert in making you write good papers. I highly recommend this course. This is a nice book to read as well, if you want to. And if you are very keen, there is 37,000 papers published on Writing in Sciences. So you can have your time reading some of these if you are free. Finally, now what is this? So this is the first publication ever known to mankind. It's actually published on a shoulder relocation technique in TIPS. It's actually showing the cooker technique. If you see here, you can find this is the shoulder dislocation. So this is the first papyrus with medical evidence, first published ever. And actually that technique is the cooker technique, published 3,000, more than 3,000 years down the line by Cooker. And it is on TIPS, and it was done by my grandfather. He published it later on in 1870. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Imam, for that wonderful explanation on how to write and publish a paper. before we get to the questions that you guys have posted, The program lead, Mr. Unithan, would like to say a few words. Just give me 1 second. Mr. Unithan?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Can you? Thank you. Guys. Thanks all of you guys for joining us. Mr. Imam has done a fantastic talk, and you can see how experienced and how important is for publish. Because if you can do as much research as possible, but if you are not publishing, you're not being fair to yourself, your patients, and to the general community about research, whether it's positive publication or negative results, they are. We all need to learn from it. And it is great to see so many people joining in regularly. We're still getting about 500 registrations. So please keep coming through, and it would be lovely to see you back for the next couple of sessions. If you have any further questions, ask us through this media or ask us through our Facebook media, and we can reply to that. It's an ordeal to join on a Saturday morning, but thanks very much for joining us. Rahul, I'll pass it on to you, and thanks Imam for such a fantastic talk.
Thank you, Mr. Unithan. It's always good to join everyone here.
Okay. Thank you for that, Mr. Unithan. So going back to the questions, Mr. Imam, there were two questions essentially, but they're not really relevant to the talk that you've given. I'm going to do the short question first.
Yes.
I'm going to say it, and then you can either contradict what I'm saying or agree. One a person asked, Zoha Khalid asked, how to persuade, I'm assuming that's pursue, clinical audits in internal medicine. I was going to suggest that we've done a talk on clinical audits, but I think towards the end of the session, you were saying that in order to publish any research or undertake any research process, you need to do your background studying of a particular topic and able to formulate a relevant research question, and then carry it out from there.
So what is the question again, Raul? I missed that, sorry.
So how to pursue clinic, she wants to know how to pursue, or she or he, I'm sorry, how to pursue clinical audits in internal medicine. It's a very generalized question, I'm afraid.
What is the difference between research and audit? You know, there can be some overlapping. So you can publish audit ideas, but the audit is actually mostly service evaluation. And there should be national standards that you compare your audit to. If you look at research, we can do a research on something that has never been done before. However, you cannot do the same for audits. So in audits, you actually have to have, so how do you pursue an audit in clinical medicine? It's actually, you work in clinical, in medicine, find an area that you think it should be improved. Like there is a new national guidance on how to manage endoscopy patients preoperatively and postoperatively. And you think that, you know, it's not done adequately. So what you should do is find an idea, same technique, find someone who can supervise you with a good expertise, and then compare this idea to national standards, register the audit, and evaluate the service based on these national standards. And then implement change. So, you know, if you find that XYZ is bad, we need to do APC. So introduce APC, re-audit it, and that's now a quality improvement project, sort of audit, re-audit process. So it should, it's all based on where you are and what's going on, and discuss it with your direct supervisors.
Okay. Fine. And the other question, again, in my opinion, a little outside the scope of this talk, is, you know, someone wants to know about how to do a clinical audit on the information of ICU deaths seen in a COVID hospital. And what is the modus operandi that needs to be followed? And I'm not laughing at the question as such, but it's more, and what is the structure of actions?
Are we doing an audit talk?
We're not. And I just don't want to.
I'm not talking about now. I'm talking as a webinar.
We already have.
Yes, I remember that. So actually, I think that would be reflected there. So audit, still, there is an audit cycle. You identify the problem, discuss it with your seniors. If you're junior, discuss with your seniors whether this, you're looking at the information. You can, most of the time, you can audit data sets or so. You don't, and then find what's going on there, do the literature review. You can follow this structure that I have mentioned about the 15 steps in a different way. And then if it is a relevant topic and you think with your with someone who is a clinical expertise that it is an important topic to audit, then go for it.
Okay. Now, a question that is relevant to what you've presented today, is in terms of reference citations, if you take a quote from a paper which has taken the same quote from a preceding paper, so then which paper should you cite? The most recent one or the one where the actual quote was taken from?
So actually, it's a good, very good question. I think it's the original paper, it's the one you should quote. And if you don't have access to the full text of the original quotation, you can quote the quoted one, but citing post papers. But it's usually the original one, because this statement was, if you don't know the original one or you miss it, it's fine. But if you're aware and it was mentioned in the quotation you're taking, you should actually quote the original paper.
Okay. And the last one was, the last one that I can see at the moment is it worth publishing case reports? If so, what information should we write in the abstract since there isn't any clear methodology involved in case reports?
So actually, case reports is a different topic, and there is always guidance for that. In case reports, then you will only write the last part of the of what we've mentioned. So we, in this study, do a case report about a case of tapir plateau fracture or a prostate cancer patient presenting with so and so. So it is a different abstract. You're just summarizing what's in that case, what is in that case report. So in abstract, if I go to PubMed now and I read, I have a patient with a tibial plateau fracture that I'm not sure it fits on the current classification, and I find in BMJ case reports there is a paper citing a different technique of managing this or a different presentation. So I'll then go and read it. So the abstract should give an idea about what is the paper about.
Okay. So the next question we have here, I guess the question is asking, is there a limit on how many references are ideal, or should we, take only the relevant, essentially, is 50 enough? Is 100 enough? Or
again, that's back to the instructions to authors. So they will mention that there is a limit for referencing. Some papers might need more referencing, like, if you're doing a network meta-analysis, comparing different techniques from different publications. But as much as you want, keep it to the relevant references. Having like 100 referencing isn't great. But there is a limit, and it will be clearly mentioned, but keep it as short as you can, only relevant topics and relevant publications. So, that's a mistake I used to do when I first started writing papers, that thinking that putting on more references would give me more weight, but actually it isn't.
Okay. And the one question that I wanted to ask was, what is your opinion in terms of when you're doing the tables and figures from a clinical research point of view, when you want to do a meta-analysis and you go review the past randomized control trials or what have you, these tables essentially give the authors who want to do the meta-analysis the information. Yes. So in your opinion, as a publisher or as an author, should you standardize or try at least to standardize your reporting of the results so that it can give the scientific community a better chance to answer the question through a meta-analysis, if applicable?
That's an excellent question, Raul. I think it's really important. You know, it's like everything else. You know, we think it's publish or perish is actually a term that sometimes make you just aim for the, you know, do publications for the sake of publishing and ignore what will happen in this paper later on. I have certain papers that have been highly cited and people have been quoting on different topics. It's all about the story, you know. So when you're writing a table, you put yourself in the shoes of the reader. So if I'm, because who is reading your paper? Is someone interested in your paper? There is three type of readers. Either someone interested in that subject and actually looking for answers in your paper, or someone reading your paper because they are doing a certain study and they want to quote your paper and find what's written in this paper, or someone who is reading the papers for sake of gaining knowledge, for sake of exams or anything, or doing a presentation or so. So the three of them would like a well-constructed, standardized table that gives them the relevant knowledge. So if you're doing meta-analysis comparing between two processes, you need to say, what sort of scores did you use? What sort of complications did they have? And what sort of outcomes did they have? And that's it, you know, certain aspects. Sometimes a reviewer might ask you for another column or so. It's, you know, it is a bit, if you think it is doable or you think it will add to your publication. So I've asked the authors to change something. They replied back with a very valid answer that we think we should keep it as it is because 1, 2, 3, 4. And it was valid options. So I told them, yes, I agree with that. That's fine. You know, so just make it, so make this publication for the sake of entertaining your readers. And so it would be more helpful and it would be a legacy that you will leave for a long time.
Okay, and there's two more questions. One is, if the references, you know, in instructions to authors, if there's no style or there's no instructions, is there any default that you can use in terms of sending the paper?
You know, I personally haven't encountered any journal that doesn't have a referencing style. And if they aren't a good journal to the extent that they don't have a referencing style, you can use whatever you want. I would say Vancouver, but if I'm in that case, you know, avoid predatory journals. There are journals for the sake of money and they have no weight. But email the journal, the editor, there will be an email for contact there and ask them before you start on using Harvard or Vancouver. But I if I'm going to choose, which didn't happen in the last so many years, I will go for Vancouver. But there is always a referencing style instruction in any journal you submit to.
And also, if you do not reference according to the style laid out in the instruction to authors, the paper would be sent back for revision, yes?
Yeah, it's actually will be sent back to you before even the editor sees it. So the way journals, because I'm an editorial board in few journals, there is an admin person or persons, however big the journal is, and these persons will just look at their checklist. Okay, you didn't mention keywords. You did the abstract wrong. The number of, the wording count is higher than what we accept. The referencing is wrong. Please do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And they will send it back to you. The editor didn't even know your paper is there. The editorial board doesn't know that as well. And reviewing didn't start even.
Okay, and the last question that I wanted to ask was, say that you've written your paper and you've sent it for peer review, and the peer reviewer, there's three, you know, reviewers, you know, one of them was positive comments, the other one was unequivocal, and the third one was critical. Now, as a first-time publisher, you might be very keen to please all of the reviewers to get your paper published, but you can also be very you know, check with your supervisors or senior colleagues and, you know, actually say, wait a second. I don't think I want to change my paper according to what the reviewer is suggesting, because I think my paper answers the question in the correct manner. So is it okay, do you think, to essentially, in a, obviously in a nice way, let the reviewer know why you, what your reasoning is for why you think those things should be included or excluded from your paper.
Very true. And another excellent question. I think also, you know, because reviewers, so basically, you know, you can be, so you can submit a journal with a senior author who's published 150 publications and a international figure. And actually, you know, this matters as well, to be fair, you know, because editors wouldn't reject papers from renowned researchers. So they will send it for review. The reviewer doesn't necessarily mean he's an expert in every journal. So he's someone who's published, definitely. And if they mention something that you're not 100, so if they mention, you know, put this instead of this, and it is doable, and it wouldn't affect the core of the paper, that's fine, you can do that. But if you're not convinced, and that happens all the time, as an author, I've always argued with reviewers. I remember a paper, but I was a fellow in Zurich, and we actually, that paper was almost rejected, and then we argued with the rejection with the editor, and it was re-reviewed, but it was, there is different ways of doing so. But if you have very valid reasons, and as I've mentioned in the talk, you're the expert in this subject, which is a study you're doing, and you think it's there was a reason doing so and so, then you can always argue with this point, and it is successful in a good in a good number of times that happened as well.
Okay. All right. I think if there is no more questions, I think.
Thank you.
We will end the conversation here. Again, please, you know, Mr. Imam has a social media and a YouTube page as well, where you can get more excellent information from his, you know, extensive wealth of knowledge that he has. So if you'd like to check that out, I think he has mentioned it earlier on. And obviously this video, along with the other sessions, will be uploaded on our Trust YouTube channel. Please feel free to reference those as and when necessary. Thank you again, Mr. Imam, for your valuable time.
Thank you, Raul, and everyone who's organized such a very good set of webinars, excellent ones. That I actually would like to have these webinars when I started writing my first paper many years ago. I think it's priceless, and all those who attended and viewing the videos are dedicated, and I'm pretty sure they will achieve what they want eventually. And if anyone needs anything, they can always free to contact me whenever needed.
All right. Thank you all, and we will take our leaves, and we will see you again at our next webinar. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Have a good day. Bye.